probably the cleanest pages of your scriptures, the book of Jonah. And if you don't know where that is, just go to Matthew, New Testament, and just turn left. If that's hard, just go to the introduction of your Bible and go right, and you'll find Jonah at some point. Okay? And meet me there as we pray. Father, thank you for this gift of your prophet Jonah. Thank you for the fact that he was humbled at some point, though not in this story, but he came to a point of surrender, and he put down on paper all of the ugliness of his own heart. And for thousands of years, Jonah has been a teacher, a master teacher. And so, Father, use the book of Jonah to push up very close to our lives, because we all have a little Jonah in us. And so, Father, remove the bitter root of stubbornness from our lives. I'll do that with the words of your scripture this morning. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. This morning, by raising your hand, I'd like you to raise your hand if you are a stubborn person. Raise your hand high. Be proud, okay? If you're stubborn. Now, everybody that didn't raise your hand, that means you are stubborn and you weren't going to raise your hand. And so I'm going to assume this, that we have 100% of stubborn people in this room here this morning, that we are a gathering of people who have stubborn hearts at times. And I want to read to you a story, an actual transcript, if you will, an actual transcript of a U.S. naval ship with Canadian authorities off the coast of Newfoundland in October 1995. It's between the Americans and the Canadians that we get this transcript. The Americans say to the Canadians, please divert your course 15 degrees to the north to avoid collision with our ship. Canadians respond, we recommend you divert your course 15 degrees to the south to avoid collision with us. Americans say, this is the captain of a U.S. Navy ship. I say again, divert your course. Canadians respond, no, I say again, you divert your course. Finally, the Americans respond, this is the aircraft carrier USS Abraham Lincoln, the second largest ship in the United States Atlantic Fleet. We are accompanied by three destroyers, three cruisers, and numerous support vessels. I demand that you change your course 15 degrees north. That's 15 degrees north, or countermeasures will be undertaken to ensure the safety of this ship. The Canadians respond, this is a lighthouse. Your call. You know, we all have a little stubborn in us, don't we? And stubbornness can quickly decay into stupidity. And the question that we have for us this morning is simply this. Where does stubbornness come from? If it's something that I don't want in my life, I would like to pull the weed of stubbornness then. And the reality is, Jonah is going to teach us that stubbornness is birthed out of rebellion. Stubbornness is birthed out of rebellion, and that's why we started last week with this phrase that we'll continue on, and it's this phrase, we must fight, everybody say fight. We must fight for our surrender. We must wage war against our own hearts and minds at times, as Paul says, to buffet our body, so that we might surrender our will to the Lord's will. Because if we don't do that, there's a growing sense of stubbornness that will take root. And Jonah is the perfect teacher for this. Remember last week, just at a review, the prophet Jonah is called by who? Who calls him? Like this half gets it and this half doesn't? Hey, Christian, who calls Jonah? God does. God calls Jonah. And he calls Jonah to go to Nineveh as the prophet. And understand this, for Jonah, this was not his first rodeo by any means. But this rodeo is different than the other times that he has spoke for God. And he's called to go to Nineveh and deliver a prophecy that judgment is coming. That the sin, the rebellion, the ugliness of the Ninevites has risen up into the nostrils of a holy God, and judgment is coming. But Jonah second guesses God. Jonah thinks he knows better. Jonah says, I'm going to do it, as Frank Sinatra would say, I'm going to do it my way. And so he runs off to Joppa, and he catches the ship that takes him over to Tarshish, if you will. And he's running from the Lord because he second-guessed God, and his rebellion is evident, and his stubbornness becomes apparent in the passage this morning. And not far from the shore, after this poor ship leaves and its poor passengers are with Jonah, not far from the shore, the storm of the century arrives. And I don't mean the California rainstorm that they say, storm of the century. I'm talking, this is a massive storm. Professional fishermen are fighting for their lives. It arrives, and we see his stubbornness front and center. Why? Because we're learning from Jonah that rebellion in the Christian life is the cancer of the soul. We learned last week that because of this, we learned that our God does not do rebellion. No, he doesn't. We may think and go, wow, he's awfully patient and he's kind, he's gracious. He is all those things, but understand this. At the end of the day, our God does not do rebellion. And so this morning, we're going to look front and center at the five attributes, if you will, of stubbornness. We're going to look at the actions of stubbornness, if you will. If it's something we want to get rid of, we need to know what it looks like so we can root it out of our lives. And here's the deal, loved ones. We're going to get ugly honest with ourselves this morning. Buyer beware, Jesus is going to crawl up into your grill this morning. Yes, he is. Because we all have this kind of nasty habit of being stubborn people. And so we're going to look at these five attributes. Number one, write this down, and we're going to jump kind of backwards starting in verse 5 this morning. But the first attribute, the first action of stubbornness that we see in Jonah that is born out of his rebellion is that stubbornness puts you in the wrong place. We will learn here in just these two verses, 5 and 6, that when you and I rebel, that we end up in some of the most dark, dead-end cul-de-sacs of our lives. And if you're like this cowboy up front, I get to the end of that cul-de-sac, and I say to myself, Todd, how in the world did you get here? Have you ever had that thought? Like, where in the world did I make this turn, and how did I get here? And the answer is simply this. Hey, Todd, your own legs brought you here. God's given you free will. There's good things to that, and there's also scary things to that. And out of my own free will, I was stubborn, and I rebelled, and I ended up in a dark, dead-end cul-de-sac. That's where Jonah is. Look at verses 5 and 6. It says, then the mariners, right after verse 4, this storm of the century comes on. Notice what happens with them. Then the mariners were afraid. And each cried out to his God, and they hurled the cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten for them. But Jonah had gone down into the inner part of the ship and had lain down and was fast asleep. So the captain came and said to him, what do you mean, you sleeper? Arise, call out to your God. Perhaps the God will give a thought to us that we may not perish. It's this moment of all gods on deck, if you will. And all of a sudden, here's these polytheists. Remember we said they're probably Phoenician fishermen who are polytheistic. They have not just hundreds, not just thousands, but maybe millions of different gods. And so they're all praying to the different god to try to save their bacon at this moment. And all of a sudden, they realize that they're in dire straits. And the reason they realize they're in dire straits is because of this mighty storm in verse 4 that is raging around them. What they don't know is the backstory of Jonah. They just want him to come up and pray to his God, but they have no idea what's really going on in the backstory. And what happens is God sent a storm. God has sent a storm and tells Jonah, you are in the wrong place. He is absolutely in the wrong place at the wrong time. We see here this morning that Jonah should have been walking to Nineveh, not boating to Tarshish. We see that Jonah in this moment should have been speaking God's message, not sleeping off his rebellion. And as we said last week, you can't sleep off rebellion. You go to bed rebellious, you wake up rebellious. You go to bed stubborn, you wake up stubborn. That's the way it works until you begin to do some heart work in your own soul. And so he's in the wrong place at the wrong time, and now a raging storm is among them. I want you to see geographically this rebellion kind of front and center. I'll look up at the screen at this map, and you can see, here he is. He lived actually about 50 miles north of Nazareth, and he goes down to Joppa, which is now about 550 miles from where he's supposed to be. He doesn't just stop there. He jumps on this prince's cruise, and he goes across all the way to where? Tarshish. He's going to end up 2,500 miles away from where God wants him to be. He's in the wrong place at the wrong time. He's in a dark, dead-end cul-de-sac. And the reason he got there wasn't because he bought the wrong ticket. The reason he got there was the stubbornness of his own heart. And when you and I, displays our stubbornness, it can take us into a zip code we never dreamed of. You see, stubbornness is not the fruit of the Spirit. It's the rotting fruit of our lives. And Jonah knows this. That's why we have to get stubborn about our stubbornness. Number two, write this down. Stubbornness breeds dishonesty. Not only does it take you to the wrong place, but when we're stubborn, we have this iron will about us where we second guess God. What happens is that stubbornness breeds dishonesty. Look at verses 7 through 9. And they said to one another, this is all the fishermen, all the professional guys on the ship who have been there and done it, and they're scared to death. And they said to one another, come let us cast lots that we may know on whose account this evil has come upon us. So they cast lots, and the lot fell on who? Jonah. You know, this is our drawing, the short straw, if you will. Casting lots, they would put rocks kind of in a box. They'd mark one rock with an X. They would shake it, and wherever the rock to the X or the X on the rock would fall out, whoever it fell to, that was where the lot fell, meaning identified short end of the stick, it's him. And the lot falls, again, according to verse 7, falls to Jonah. Then they said to him, tell us on whose account this evil has come upon us. What is your occupation? Where did you come from? What is your country? And what people are you? And where are you on Facebook? I mean, they're asking all kinds of questions. Because they want to narrow this in as quick as possible, because here it is, the lot fell to him. Verse 9, notice what he says. And he said to them, I am a Hebrew, and I fear the Lord. I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land. And the reason this breeds dishonesty is, first and foremost, if Jonah was a man, a real spiritual, godly man, he would have manned up at the point in time and said, you know what? Don't even cast lots. It's me. It's me. I'm the one that's doing this. If Jonah was really had a soft heart and his stubbornness had dissipated, he would have tapped out and said, it's me. Don't even cast lots. I'm jumping overboard. I'm sorry to trouble you people, but Jonah is still displaying his stubbornness at this moment. And notice the dishonesty in this. You say, well, what do you mean? Well, look at it with your own eyes. He answers their question, but doesn't tell them anymore. He tells them, and he says, I am a Hebrew. I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land. Well, what he should have said, guys, let me just tell you why this is happening. I'm a prophet of God, the Lord God Jehovah, and he asked me to do something. And I'll be honest with you, boys, I am in complete rebellion and stubbornness with him. And the reason you think you're about to die is because you're about to die, and it's not your fault, it's my fault. And so if you don't mind, here's what I'm going to do. I'm just going to jump overboard and see what the Lord does. But instead, he hides behind his stubbornness, and he says, you know what? I'm going to tell you the truth, but not necessarily the whole truth. He had a chance to come clean in this moment, but he doesn't come completely clean because he's being stubborn. And I'll tell you this, I have Jonah in me. Do you have Jonah in you? A sense of stubbornness of, man, I just don't want to break yet. I don't want to give in. I don't want to stop doing what I'm doing. Because to be honest with you, I kind of like what I'm doing. In fact, it's kind of pleasurable. And the sense of, man, I'd rather lie to the people I love than actually stop my behavior. Why? Because you're stubborn. Why do I do it? Because I'm stubborn. And we got to realize that, understand this, is that, man, if we don't bend, God will break us. And there's a point in time where we have to come to a point of surrender. We surrender our stubbornness to him. And if we don't bend, he will break. That's why as a Christ follower this morning is we got to get stubborn about our stubbornness. You see, number three, write this down. Stubbornness hurts. Everybody say hurts. Stubbornness hurts those around us. Don't for a minute believe that your personal stubbornness is private. Because that's what Jonah was thinking. It's just me. I'm just going to go down to Joppa and catch a boat somewhere, and it's just a me thing. But it wasn't a me thing. It was all of them. Look at verses 10 through 13. The men were exceedingly afraid. And they find out who this guy is. Now they're afraid. He says, they say, what is this that you have done? For the men knew that he was fleeing from the presence of the Lord. I know you're running, but what did you do? Come clean with us. Because he had told them. Verse 11, they said to him, what shall we do to you that the sea may quiet down for us? You got the lot, Jonah. What do we need to do here? For the sea grew more and more tempestuous. And he said to them, here's what you do. Pick me up and hurl me into the sea. Then the sea will quiet down for you, for I know it is because of me that this great tempest has come upon you. Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to get back to dry land, but they could not, for the sea grew more and more tempestuous against them. Even in this moment, you see the stubbornness in verse 12. He says to them, the lot identifies him. He doesn't come totally clean. He just says, I'm a Hebrew. They figure out he's a Hebrew. He's irritated his God by doing something we don't know because he hadn't told us. And what he should have done, if he was a man of God, he should have said, it is because of me, and here's the deal. I'm going to just jump into the sea, and I'm going to take care of this and end it. But you can almost see like, hey, I know it's my fault, but you guys throw me in. I mean, the stubbornness continues. It's not like, well, I don't know how to jump in the water. I have never jumped in the water before in my life. I don't even know how to jump in the water. This is crazy. Of course he knows how to jump in the water. He knew how to walk the Joppa. He can jump out into the water. But he says, you know what? You guys pick me up as if they didn't have enough to do. They're throwing things over. They're trying to save their lives. Okay, pick him up. They're throwing him over. Hey, Jonah, why don't you just dive in? It's because of his stubbornness. It's because of his stubbornness. Notice verse 12. Just let your eyes drop there. He says, for I know it is because of me. He doesn't tell him what it is, but he knows it's because of me that this great tempest has come upon you. Well, Jonah, that's not real hard for us to figure out. The lot fell to you. You know, like, great, thanks for sharing, but we kind of knew that. It's because of me. Notice what he does here. He acknowledges his sin, but he doesn't repent from it. This is a life lesson for all of us in this room. Acknowledgement isn't repentance. Oh, it's a form of it. It's a part of it. It's a good step one. But we don't see Jonah repent until chapter 2, and he's even in a worse place. But he thinks, oh, I'll just acknowledge it. It's really because of me. I don't need to tell you the whole story. And here's the deal. Why don't you guys throw me in? His stubbornness, though, the sad part, doesn't just affect him. It affects the whole ship. You see, when you think about the story, because this is a true story, not a fairy tale, is there was a true captain on this ship. And this captain, guess what he had? He had a wife and he had kids. And his life is about to be taken, and that family is going to become husbandless and fatherless in a stage of history that is the worst thing that could fall onto a family. Not only is there a captain, but there's actually fishermen. There's more men on the boat, and guess what they have? They have wives, and they have kids. And they're about to lose dad and husband. They have no idea that it's this little Hebrew boy that is not obeying God that is causing them to be in harm's way. Not only that, but there's an employer who owns this boat who has these goods being shipped to Tarshish, and they're supposed to go to Tarshish, and now they're going into the water. And now he's affecting somebody's business. There's somebody who's not going to get a paycheck because the boat doesn't bring the goods. And Christ, Father, we have to understand that our own personal stubbornness is not kept neatly contained just inside of ourselves. It affects those around us. And we have to step back and say, man, am I just being stubborn? Am I just wanting to be Frank Sinatra and do it my way? Me, myself, and I, the Holy Trinity, and that's what I'm going to do? Because it only affects me. Well, that's not true. It affects, our stubbornness affects a boatload, pun intended, of others. You see, our own personal sin of stubbornness can affect and infest an entire church family. Our stubbornness can infect and infest our entire personal family. And it's high time that we, as Christ followers, we realize that puberty's over and it's time to grow up. And it's time to say, Lord, soften my heart, soften my heart. My stubbornness is affecting people around me. Do you understand that's the gospel? Remember in Ezekiel chapter 11, verse 19, God says in a prophetic word to us that someday he's going to take the heart of stone out of us, the heart of stubbornness out of us, and put in a heart of flesh that is malleable, that is pliable, that is soft and tender. And the reality is, if we don't do heart checks on a regular basis, we can develop a very callousness to us and we become very stubborn to those around us. And here's the deal. I'm not just, you know, capping on you. It starts with this cowboy up front. Is that we have to say, Lord, man, soften my heart today. Because the reality is, in a room this size with this many people, there are some people in this room, you just need to hear this, that your stubbornness is killing your family. It is killing your family. And what's the deal? The deal is this, is man, Lord, help me bend before I break. And here's the deal. I don't want to second guess you. I trust you. I want to move forward in obedience. I don't want to be double-minded in this. That's really where it comes from. It comes from the double-mindedness of, oh, I want to be God's prophet, but I want to do it my way. Remember James, the half-brother of Jesus? How cool is that? Hey, who's your family? Well, it's kind of related to Jesus. That's a great bio. Half-brother of Jesus, who thought his brother was crazy, until he appeared resurrected. That's kind of what happens when your brother rises from the dead. You become a believer pretty quick. And he sees Jesus and he becomes a great pastor for his Savior, not big brother, his Savior. And remember in his epistle in James chapter 1 verse 8, he says, hey, Crossroads, don't be double-minded. Don't be double-minded. This idea, I want to be the prophet of God, but I want to do it my way. That's double-mindedness. I want to love Jesus, but I want to enjoy this. I really want to obey God, but I want to take pleasure in this. That's double-mindedness. The Greek word double-minded there is the Greek word dipsuko. Dipsuko. I always remember that verse because I remind myself God doesn't want me to be a dipstick. Right? Dipsuko. God doesn't want me to be a dipsuko. Some of you are a dipsuko right now. You want to do it your way, but we're at church. And the reality is that we have to say, Lord, soften our heart, because if we don't, we end up hurting by our stubbornness. We begin hurting those that we love the most. This may surprise some of you, but every once in a while, Stacy and I have a discussion. Anybody in this room, any married people have discussions? The way our discussions usually end up because of my stubbornness. Because see, my wife is 99.9% right all of the time. The other 0.1% is that she's mostly right. So, I mean, she's basically 100% right. But I get stubborn. And the way it sometimes ends, I don't know if it ends in your house this way, but it ends with her upstairs and me downstairs. Which I actually prefer because I got the kitchen. And the way the Lord works on me is he brings that verse that just kills me every time. Romans 5:8, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Which reminds me, the greater person in the relationship always initiates the repentance, the confession. The stronger person in a relationship always initiates, "I'm sorry." And so I go upstairs, because I got that verse just ringing in my ear, like, enough, enough, I got it. Go up there, and I'll tell you this, "I'm sorry, I was wrong, please forgive me," are some of the simplest phrases in the Christian English language there is, but they are the most freeing. "I'm sorry, I was wrong, please forgive me." Let's try this together. "I'm sorry, I was wrong, please forgive me." Now, if you're fighting with somebody next to you right now, that doesn't count as confession, okay? Because that was a corporate action, not a self-independent will of the heart. But that's what Jonah needed to do, and he doesn't do it until chapter 2. He doesn't repent. He doesn't confess. He doesn't grow up. And he's putting those around him in grave danger. That's why number 4, write this down, stubbornness also stops healthy fear. Stubbornness stops healthy fear. Look at verses 14 through 16. "Therefore they called out to the Lord." Who's they? It's the fishermen. They hear Jonah's deal. "Oh Lord, here's these Phoenicians, polytheists, praying to Jonah's God. Oh Lord, let us not perish for this man's life, and lay not on us innocent blood, for you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you." Isn't it crazy? And isn't it shocking when the pagans have better theology than the Christian? They get it. So verse 15, "So they picked up Jonah and hurled him into the sea. And the sea ceased from its raging." And then I love verse 16. "Then the men feared the Lord exceedingly, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows." If you get the Hebrew on this, it says that when it ceased, it just went from total chaos to complete calm. And in the chaos part, they're scared to death. And then the calmness, they're really scared to death. They think they're about to die, and now they're like, "I think I really will die, because this God's gonna take us out." He calmed the sea instantaneously, and they learned a lesson. What's worse than an almighty storm outside your boat is when Almighty God ends up in your boat, and it freaked them out. And so there was a healthy fear here. And I get it. The text does not say Jonah stopped fearing God, but it's implicit. In fact, it's baked right into the passage. Because when Jonah put this down on parchment, he juxtaposed it with his lack of fear of God. "I second guess you. I do it my way." And he juxtaposed it by kissing up the actions of these pagan men who are now fearful of this God. In essence, what he's screaming at us is, "I stopped having a healthy fear of God, and they started." And it makes a grave point. And here's the question is, do you still fear God? I mean, do you have a healthy fear of God? If you are bound right now, and your feet are in cement of sin, and you feel like you are trapped in it, what you need to pray for is a healthy fear of God. And I get it all. Every time the preacher preaches, it's a respectful fear, it's a reverential fear. I'll tell you, and you see, God, it's a scary fear. I understand. We don't. He hasn't given us a spirit of timidity. He's cast out all fear. There's no judgment coming. But understand, in the presence of a holy God, even a redeemed man stands there with great reverence. And let me just tell you what it is: fear of a holy one. And we seem to lose that. And one of the things that we can become very sensitized to sin is if we pray for a greater fear of the Father. A greater fear of the Father. You're stuck in sin. "Lord, help me fear you that, man, I fear you more than I enjoy this pleasure. I fear you more than telling this lie. I'm more afraid of you than I am of them. I fear the Creator more than I do the creation." And we fear the Father. I have three very expensive kids. And I won't use his name, but one of my kids. And, you know, you parents, this is not a new story. You've been there. Again, I won't use his name, but he was giving lip to Stacy. And so I said to him, you know, upstairs. Let him kind of sit for a while. And then I go up there. Open the door, go in. And I looked at him and I said, here's the deal, dude. Don't ever talk to my wife that way again. Like, what? I said, it's real clear. Nobody speaks to my wife that way. And that will be the last time you ever say that to my wife. You know what he had? He had a healthy fear of the Father. Yes, he did. And I'm so thankful. That healthy fear of the earthly Father has been moving into a healthy fear of the spiritual Father. And I'm thankful for that. See, a fear is a good thing. Fear keeps our fingers out of fires. Fear keeps us from jumping off buildings. And fear keeps us from running into the street. And fear keeps us on a straight path. The fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. Only a fool stops fearing God. We must learn to fear the Creator more than the creation. We must stop our stubbornness. This morning, I would say this, fear God so much that you say to yourself this morning, the stubbornness stops here. You remember as when you were raising kids, if you're already kind of past that stage, or some of you are right there, right now, remember your two-year-old, your three-year-old, the very first time they gave you the neck, and when you said to them, hey, look at me, and they went, right? And you got that vein kind of coming out on your kid. And they're thinking, if I don't look at you, you don't exist, right? And look at me. You know what God said to his people? He called his people, you stubborn-necked people. You stiff-necked people. That's what he called his own people. If you read the Old Testament, I'll tell you what the story is. It's a story about stubbornness. And it's high time that some of us in this room stop giving the Lord the stiff neck. Why? Because stubbornness stops a healthy fear. Number five, the first one being this, stubbornness puts you in the wrong place. Stubbornness, number two, breeds dishonesty. Number three, stubbornness hurts those around us. And number four, stubbornness stops healthy fear. And number five, stubbornness reports. You guys want some good news? Anybody in this room want some good news? Yes. Stubbornness reports to the sovereign one. This is such great news. Stubbornness reports to the sovereign. Look at verse 17. After he gets thrown into the water, and the Lord appointed a great fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days, 3 nights. We'll talk about that next week. But I just want you to circle the word appointed in your neighbor's Bible because they need to see this. Don't miss that word. That is a monumental word in the Old Testament. The Lord appointed. See, what is a reminder is that in Jonah's stubbornness, in all of our stubbornness, it all reports, all surrenders, and is all subject to a sovereign God. And so what's happening is Phoenicians throw Jonah out, and God's looking at his prophet, who's sinking to the bottom, and he's looking at this fish, and he says, fish. Jonah, fish swims right over there, gets a happy meal, and boom, God's in control. It wasn't by accident. It didn't say, and by accident, dumb luck, there's a big fish. It's not like, oh, it threw him into, oh, wow, threw him into SeaWorld, and there's Shamu. Bummer. No, this is God's sovereign plan. He appointed, he picked before the foundation of the world, a big fish to swallow up this prophet. Let me prove this to you, to some of you that are stubborn. Let me prove this to you. Look at verse 4, chapter 1. But the Lord hurled a great wind. Now let your eyes drop down to verse 15 of Jonah, chapter 1. And the sea ceased from its raging. God stops the sea. Verse 17, and the Lord appointed a great fish. Look down to chapter 2, verse 3. For you cast me into the deep, Jonah says. It's God doing this. Look down at verse 10 of chapter 2. And the Lord spoke to the fish. Turn over to chapter 4 and look at verse 6. Now the Lord God appointed a plant. Verse 7, and God appointed a worm. Verse 8, and God appointed a scorching east wind. Who's the big actor in this? God. This isn't a story about a big fish. This is a story about a big God. And some of you are so stubborn, you're sitting in the water and you're thinking, it can't get any worse. And the Lord's sitting up there going, fish. Why? Because our stubbornness has to report to the sovereign one. Jonah puts himself in a boat. God puts Jonah in a fish. And I say to some of you this morning, understand this, that in the midst of your stubbornness, in the midst of your rebellion, you are under the umbrella of the sovereignty of God. Moms, some of you that literally drench the pillowcase every night because of your tears, because you have a Jonah. You have a real life Jonah, and you're wondering, where is she? Where is he? I'll tell you where they are. Isaiah 40, verse 12. Isaiah 40, verse 12. Isaiah says this, O Lord, your oceans, your seas are marked in the palm of your hand. You know what that tells me? Jonah is in a fish. A fish is in an ocean. And the ocean is in God's hand. Moms, where are they? Total rebellion. Total stubbornness, sitting in the middle of a sovereign hand. And I don't know when they're going to get spit out. Thief on the cross, kind of at the end. They get spit out. See, our stubbornness, our rebellion reports to the sovereign hand. And here we are watching Jonah thinking he's in control. He's going to do it my way, going to Tarshish. And God says, you're not going to do it your way. Jonah, you have zero control. Christians, let me tell you something. Every eye up here for a moment. Let me tell you something. Control in life is a farce. It's a sham. If you think you are in control, you have bitten the apple and you have bought the lie. We are in control of squat. I mean, we think we're all the big cheese head honcho. I'm the head of my family. You control squat. You report to a sovereign one. And we see the relentless grace of God, the relentless patience of God. He doesn't do stubborn, and he will break Jonah down. And Jonah thinks he's in control, and he is in control of nothing. The Smiths are square in the middle of this issue right now, just to be totally open with you. We're dealing with a person. We're dealing with this individual, I guess I would say, who thinks they're in control of our lives. It's been hard, very hard. Because a week ago, we got a puppy. Yeah. That's little Riley. He's totally pagan, or she's totally a pagan. She's a paganess. And little Riley, who's just 9 pounds, she's a little Bernadoodle. She's a bundle of rebellion. She's a bundle of stubbornness. We should have called her Jonah. And she thinks she's the big cheese, the head honcho, and the big boss in our home. She thinks she calls the shots. She thinks we rise and fall at her command. She's 9 pounds. She sees a 100-pound dog, and she barks at it, which sounds like a whelp. It's like, stop it, Riley. You're embarrassing yourself. But she thinks she controls everything. And I look at her, and she gives me that stiff neck. And I'm like, Riley, you could go to the pound tomorrow. Like first thing in the morning. And then I think, isn't it great that we have a Savior who doesn't think that way? He doesn't sit up there and say, hey, Smith, you could go to the pound tomorrow. But he just says, oh, I got you. I got you. You think you're in control? You're kind of like that pup, Todd. You control squat. I control everything. Amen.